when we can't travel at all. So I think it's also a very interesting time to be in the neutrophil field, which is now particularly fast paced and, you know, lots of new insights that are sort of departing from previously held paradigms. And I think this is best illustrated by the papers that we're going to discuss today. So without further ado, I'm going to start by introducing the first speaker. And this is Iván Ballesteros, who did his PhD at the School of Medicine in Complutense University in Spain, and then was postdoc in the laboratory of Andres Hidalgo in the Spanish National Cardiovascular Research Center. And he's going to be talking about his recent paper, which was published in Cell in November 2020, entitled Co-option of Neutrophil Fates by Tissue Environments. So over to you, Iván.
Thank you, Borko. I'm going to share my screen. And okay, can you see? Yeah. So thank you for inviting me to this symposium. I really think scientific discussion needs to be boosted and in a friendly way, and discussing today neutrophils, and I found really interesting papers that we are going to talk today. Mine is about neutrophils in homeostasis, and basically, when we talk about neutrophils, we'll think about cells that kill pathogens, and they do it in different ways: phagocytosis, the granulation of microbacterial peptides, netosis, and of course, when there is an inflammation or infection, they go to the tissues and they do the same. They have this machinery that may harm the tissue. So it is not surprising that neutrophils are known cells that are disease-modifying cells. No, for example, in cancer, we have neutrophils that have pro-tumoral activity or anti-tumoral activity, and it happens the same in different diseases. So they are very heterogeneous, and we want to understand better the source of this heterogeneity. So this is all very clear, or well, more clear in pathological condition, but under homeostasis, what we know about neutrophils is that they are released from the bone marrow and they stay in the blood, and the half-life of neutrophils in circulation has been estimated in around 7 hours. And then they are going to the liver, to the spleen, or to the bone marrow, where they are thought to be phagocytosed by tissue phagocytes. So they don't stay that much in tissues. So this is our question. We were wondering, this is everything about neutrophils in homeostasis. They are released to the circulation and then they are phagocytosed in tissues and they stay only 7 hours around in the blood. So previous results from my laboratory identify that neutrophils can be found in healthy tissues. These are tissues without infection, without inflammation, and we can find neutrophils almost in every tissue that we look, with the exception of the brain and the gonads. And some of these neutrophils can be found inside the vessels. And this is a clear example here below. I showed you the lung. Neutrophils are mostly intravascular in the lungs, and they also can be found extravascularly. And I showed you here the examples of the neutrophils in the colon submucosa, close to the isolated lymphoid follicles, which are areas of the colon submucosa full of B cells. So, and you may think that this may be a passive contamination from the blood. They are in the blood and they go to the tissues. But I am going to show you one evidence based on circadian biology, which is something that in our lab we do a lot. And to show you that this is not a passive retention. So what we know is that neutrophil levels in the blood, they change circadianly. So we have a peak of neutrophils in circulation early in the morning, and then we have a plateau in the beginning of the evening. So if we take the tissues and we also check for the levels of neutrophils and tissues, and I'm going to put the example of the lung, which you can see here in this graph is this dot line, which is the blood levels. So you can see that the levels of neutrophils in the lung goes antiphasic with the levels of neutrophils in the blood. The same can be seen in the skin, in the bone marrow, or in the spleen. So showing us that this is not a passive retention because of the blood, they get activated, stuck in the lung, in the vessels of the lung, even if we have a plateau of neutrophils circulating in blood. So we wanted to see if these neutrophils that we find in tissues, they have a different half-life. And for that, we created an inducible reporter for neutrophils, these lysis-G tomato mice, in which when we inject tamoxifen, we label neutrophils with tomato, and we can identify them in the bone marrow as mature neutrophils, that they are CXCR2 high neutrophils. These mature neutrophils are starting to appear in the blood as early as day 2 after tamoxifen, and they reach a peak at day 3. So with this dynamic, what we wanted to study is the half-life of neutrophils and how we did it. We injected tamoxifen and analyzed different tissues at different time points after tamoxifen injection. And we collaborated with Gabriel Fernandez Calvo, which is a mathematician also from Spain, who performed a mathematical model to determine the half-life of neutrophils in tissue based on the decay of the number of positive tomato positive neutrophils. So when he did this modeling, what we found is that the half-life of neutrophils in the different tissues range between 10 hours to 18 hours in the skin. Well, this is what has been basically described for the blood, more or less 10 hours, 7 hours. But the most interesting here is that also the lifespan of some of these neutrophils was longer even than 24 hours. So telling us that the neutrophils may not be immediately eliminated when they go into the tissue. So the next question that we wonder is that if they stay in the tissues enough time, will they be able to acquire a tissue-specific signature? So for that, we performed several analyses. This is a site of analysis in which we took leukocytes from the different tissues that I show you here. And here you have the Disney plot of this site of analysis. And if we look at the macrophages, for example, what we clearly see is that they cluster in clusters depending on the tissue of origin. And this is what it expected, because the macrophages is like the canonical myeloid cell that display a tissue-specific signature. But if we have a look at the neutrophils, we also see that they also cluster depending on the tissue of origin, so suggesting that or indicating that we can identify different profiles at the level of the proteins in neutrophils from the different tissues. We perform the same analysis at the RNA level with single cell sequencing analysis, and you can also see that this is a Disney clusterization of the neutrophils from these tissues, and you can also see that we can identify specific clusters depending on the tissue that they come from. And of course, we can identify different transcript specific for each neutrophils from each tissue. And we wanted to characterize better this specific signature of neutrophils. So for that, we perform bulk sequencing, because you can get much more transcripts per sample than what we get with single cell sequencing analysis. And again, we identify, and this is extended to more tissues, we identify a tissue-specific transcriptional profile for the neutrophils from the different tissues. And here you can see the neutrophils that we saw. They are normal neutrophils, the multi-lobe nuclei, you can see it clearly, but they have different transcriptional signatures. And this is an estimation, but just to show you that these differentially expressed transcripts in macrophages goes around 1 to 3% of the transcriptome. So it's differentially expressed between different tissues. In the case of neutrophils, this also is in that range between 1 and 6%. So indicating that these changes that we identify in the transcriptome are important if we compare it with the one that we already know was happening with the macrophages. We also detected heterogeneity at the DNA level, and for that, this is we perform ATAC sequencing analysis. So what I showed you here is a principal component analysis in which you can see that the neutrophil samples from tissues cluster together. So there is also differences at the DNA level, and the open chromatin of the locus that we identify in several cases, they match with our previous RNA analysis. So we were confident that the changes were happening at the DNA, RNA, and protein level in the neutrophils from the different tissues. So we took all this information and we performed in silico characterization of their function. And what we first saw is that chemotaxis and immune responses, which are canonical function of neutrophils, are very enriched in the blood and in the bone marrow. But more surprisingly for us was to identify non-canonical function of neutrophils from the lung or intestine. As you can see, they seem to be enriched in angiogenesis and neuronal developmental functions. And also we identify that neutrophils from the hematopoietic organs, they seem to be important for the homeostasis, for leukocyte homeostasis. And we wanted to validate this function. So we did is to take wild-type mice and neutropenic mice, we irradiate them, and then we measure the recovery following irradiation of the hematopoietic, the recovery of the hematopoietic system. And here, if you look, for example, at the spleen, you can see that the spleen of the neutropenic mice is has an important atrophy. Is the weight is lower than the one identifying the control, and the number of B cells is quite reduced. We can see this also in the bone marrow, and we have also the counts for different leukocytes that we perform by flow cytometry analysis. So it seems that neutrophils are important for the recovery of the hematopoietic system. And when we check for angiogenesis, what we did is to analyze the percentage of endothelium in the lung that is proliferating. So if you look at this graph here, you can see that in basal condition in adult mice, around 0.2% of the endothelium is actively proliferating. But if we look at mice, rapid growing mice, 4 week old mice, the percentage of the endothelium that proliferates in the lung is bigger, it's around 3% or more. And the interesting thing here is that when we deplete neutrophil, we abolish the proliferation that we see in this rapid growing mice. The same is seen after irradiation. After irradiation, the endothelium in the lung proliferates more. And when we deplete neutrophils, we see that this proliferation is also abolished. We found the same results in the intestine. So this correlates with our in silico predicted function, and also in the intestine, as we know that neutrophils localize surrounding the isolated lymphoid follicles of the submucosa. We measure the vessels and what we found is that in mice without neutrophils, you can see that the number of vessels, the area of the vessels that covers the isolated lymphoid follicles is quite reduced. And in other areas of the submucosa, we didn't find that. And these areas of the submucosa are not enriched in neutrophils. The most enriched one is the one in the ILF, the neutrophils surrounding these areas. So, of course, we wanted to know the mechanism by which neutrophils specify. And the first thing we did is to take the lung neutrophils from our single-cell data set. And this is the Disney plot, the blood neutrophils. So this is the Disney plot only of the blood neutrophils, the circulating pool. And we overlay our tissue-specific signatures in these Disney plots. And what we saw is that we could not identify any tissue-specific signature of the neutrophils in a circulation. In addition, what we did is to join two mouse in parabiosis, and then we took their tissues and performed mass cytometry with the same cocktail as I showed you before. And this is a Disney only for the neutrophils from the partner derived and the host mouse in parabiosis. And basically what we see is that the circulating neutrophils that come from the partner, they acquire the same profile as the ones of the host. And finally, what we did to determine if this specification is taking place in the tissue is to inject directly bone marrow neutrophils into the lung. And then we determine their transcriptional profile. And I want you to focus on this orange bar here. These are the transfer neutrophils. And what you can see is that the transfer neutrophils acquire all the transcripts associated to the lung signature. And finally, we wanted to look for the mechanism. So we perform a molecular screening for neutrophil specification. We took lung neutrophils because they are a lot, they are easy to isolate, and we know very well their signature in comparison to other tissues. So I just want you to focus to the neutrophils that are deficient in CXCR4, which are here. And you can see that these neutrophils has problem to specify to the lung signature. So when we take these deficient neutrophils in CXCR4, we found several problems in colonization of the lung, but also in dynamics. These are neutrophils crawling through the lung vasculature. This was taken by a former postdoc of the lab. What you can see, and I'm going to play again the video, it was taken by Jose Adrover. What you can see that the wild-type neutrophils, they patrol the vasculature very well. The neutrophils without CXCR4, they seem that they are lost. They move less, and they seem that they are lost. And what we did after that is we took a CXCL12 GFP mouse, and we took the lung and we performed an immunofluorescence in which we add lysis G to identify neutrophils. And what we see here is that the neutrophils are very close to these CXCL12 positive vessels of the lung. So I forgot to mention CXCL12 is the canonical ligand for CXCR4. So it was suggesting that there may be a niche for neutrophil in the lung that is associated to CXCL12 positive vessels. So they are not randomly distributed, they are close to these vessels. And we have the same results using an antagonist for CXCR4, AMD. So these are tracks also for live imaging. The neutrophils are being imaged, the lung crawling the lung vasculature. And when we add the drug, the AMD, and we wait like 10 minutes, what we see instantaneously is that the neutrophils stop crawling. And also, interestingly, when we add the AMD drug, what we see is that the neutrophils stay farther from the CXCL12 GFP positive vessels. So indicating us that this can also recapitulate the phenotype that we observe in the CXCR4 deficient neutrophils. And also it recapitulates the phenotype that we see in the neutropenic mice, because in terms of angiogenesis, because when we radiate a CXCR4 deficient mouse where only neutrophils, this is specific for neutrophil, the upregulation of the proliferation of the endothelium is also altered. And we also identify that in the isolated lymphoid follicles of these mice, of the CXCR4 deficient in neutrophils, we found less vessels in these areas, as we saw previously with the neutropenic mice. So this is showing us that the specification at the transcriptional level has also an effect at the functional level. So basically what I showed you today is that neutrophils that are released to the circulation, they can go through the tissues, they can interact with the environment, specify and acquire tissue-specific functions. And I also showed you today that in the case of the lung, we can identify a niche where neutrophils associate, which is a niche of vessels that express CXCL12. So this is everything I wanted to tell you today. I would like to thanks to my lab and to my mentor Andres Hidalgo and everybody in the lab, especially to Andrea Rubio, who is the bioinformatician who performed all this analysis, and to our international collaborators, Renato Stuni from Milan for single cell sequencing, Lai Wan En from Singapore for the CyTOF, and Irina Udalova also from Oxford University for her help with the ATAC sequencing experiments. So that's everything. So if you want to ask any question, I will be happy to answer.
Thank you, Ivan. I'm sure you would get a big round of applause if you're talking in person. Really fascinating data and great presentation. Maybe I'll start by asking if you could comment on this. I thought the CXCL12, CXCR4 interaction was really interesting, but a very similar interaction also happens originally in the bone marrow, right? Before the neutrophils are released. Yet transcriptionally, they're very different from bone marrow cells. So are you saying that this is just one of multiple interactions that's required to program them in this way?
Well, what we know about the CXCL12 niche is that we can clearly identify in the lung. So the neutrophils are very associated to that. And if there is no attraction to this niche, they do not specify. In the case of the bone marrow, because it's full of CXCL12, we cannot really identify a specific niche for the neutrophils in the bone marrow, but maybe because it's full and we don't have the spatial resolution to find it. So yes, it's important for the release of the neutrophils from the bone marrow, this axis, CXCL12, CXCR4. And that's why we perform the AMD experiments, because you may know that the neutrophils that are deficient in CXCR4, the mice are neutrophilic. The neutrophil leave the bone marrow very fast and it can have problems of maturation. So that's why I'm showing you also the experiments with the drug directly in the lung, very fast, on checking only the neutrophils that are in the field 20 minutes after the administration of the drug to make sure that it's not an effect of these neutrophilia and maturation problem that these mice have. But yeah, these mice have some problems, of course, yeah.
Thanks. I'm going to go to one of the questions from the audience now. It's actually a question from Min Soo Kim. So regarding the tissue-specific neutrophils, how do you know their history? For example, some neutrophils can first home to the liver and then migrate to the spleen, etc.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question because we don't know. What you expect is that they would go to, for example, to the lung, they would stay there and they will go somewhere else. And that's something we are trying to do now. We're trying to figure out which is their journey. If they go first to a place and then to another one, and if they specify in one place and they have a new function when they are there and they can move to another place. But yes, this is a very, very intriguing question and very difficult to answer with the tools that we have. We are thinking our best to answer this, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. And then there's another question basically asking, what do you think happens under inflammatory conditions in the tissues?
Yeah, so if we think about the niche theory that there may be only some niches available where the neutrophil can change and reprogram, if there is inflammation, there would be a lot of neutrophils. There won't be a place for all of them. So probably most of them won't specify. And this is an hypothesis that we have. So we will have neutrophils with a blood signature that won't be able to specify which is the function, which is the difference. This is something we need to address. Yeah.
Good. There was then also a question or a comment that says depletion by radiation may affect other cells. Have you tried a more specific neutrophil depletion?
No. The depletion was performed with DTR, with DT toxin. So the mice are the MRP8-CRE, which is a specific driver, specific for neutrophils. And so when you inject DT, you really get the mouse neutropenic. The irradiation is only to assess for the recovery of the hematopoietic system or to burst the proliferation of the endothelium. So we use irradiation as a model, but the depletion is with the MRPA DTR model.
Okay, great. Next question. Great talk. I was wondering if you functionally characterize that population of neutrophils that interact with CXCL12 in the lung, do they display a phenotype similar to activated neutrophils?
Some of the transcripts may indicate activation, but others are not associated to that at all. So, yeah.
Great. And then I was wondering this might be speculation, but do you think that neutrophils are cleared differently in different tissues, right? So the mechanism of clearance. I know very little is known about this, so that's why I said you might speculate. I don't know if you have any ideas on this.
Well, what is thought is that they mostly clear in the liver, spleen, and bone marrow, but we didn't test it directly in the lab. We like to test things that are known and see what happened, like this of the specification. But I don't know if in the lung they are also clear, for example, or in other tissues. I don't know if there is a specific place where they are clear. The experiments show that the liver is important, the spleen is important, but yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Ivan.
Hi.
Can I ask just a quick question before
sure.
we finish? So have you thought about myeloid drive suppressor cells phenotypes in your tissue-specific homing pattern? You know, some neutrophils can be suppressor cells in a certain environment.
Yeah.
So maybe your homing pattern might be related with their sort of tissue-specific or location-specific myeloid drive suppressor cell phenotypes.
Yeah, we think that in a specific tissues, maybe the lung, for example, they may acquire some immunosuppression function, but we don't know, and we don't know exactly. And also, we should check in cancer what's going on in cancer and how these. Well, this was the main idea, no? To see what happened in the homeostasis. So now we have all this formation. Let's revisit the the cancer or revisit other inflammatory conditions and see how this all goes together. We don't know, but yeah.
Sorry. Final question, Ivan. There's a question about IL-1. The lung neutrophils were IL-1 beta high. Do you know if it matures to IL-1 beta protein in relevant amounts?
We tested by flow cytometry, and the pro IL-1 beta was showing clearly differentially pattern in the lungs. So yes, there must be protein made in the lungs. IL-1 beta, yeah.